Hi friends, welcome to Smart News Digital. Let's have discussion for the date 26th July 2018. These are the six topics we are going to discuss today. Today's first topic is India-Africa relations. Africa's global outreach is changing with times. Once it was driven by its engagement with developed countries. It was looking for developed countries for developing itself. But now it is changing. It is shifting towards Asia. Whereas in Asia also, emerging powers like India and China gaining self-confidence and is looking to tap the opportunities that is available in Africa. There have been 23 high-level visits from India to Africa for the past 4 years. It shows that the seriousness and intensity from India's side towards Africa to engage with Africa, to have win-win situation, to have mutual benefit for both. While Uganda has seen already prime minister level visits, but when it comes to Rwanda, this is the first time Indian prime minister is visiting Rwanda. Rwanda is one country which is having a very close relationship with India, and India is maintaining its relationship with Rwanda very nicely. For the last year, India elevated its ties with Rwanda to the level of strategic partnership. Let's see something about Rwanda. Its president Paul Kagame is the chair of African Union. After the end of its civil war, Rwanda is moving towards recovery and national reconciliation. We have to be proud that there are 3,000 Indian nationals and persons of Indian origins are present. You will be surprised to know that Rwanda's only sugar refinery and its modern textile industry and its soap factory are all belong to persons of Indian origin. Rwandans have always maintained a positive attitude towards Indian community. In the infamous 1994 genocide, around 5 lakh to 10 lakh people were massacred in Rwanda. Not even a single Indian or persons of Indian origin have been killed. During that time, India went for evacuation. There was no interference from the government or the people. This shows that they have huge respect for Indians. Lake Kivu shares borders of the countries like Rwanda and DRC. India's promise to open an embassy in Rwanda is a welcome step. India's democracy was a template for many African countries that were transitioned from colonialism to democracy. Let's see something about Uganda also. It drew its inspiration, that is, Uganda's activist drew inspiration from India's independence. Uganda's early activist drew inspiration from India's independence. Uganda got independence in 1962. In 1965 itself, India established diplomatic presence in Uganda. Let's see something about Lake Victoria also. Lake Victoria shares borders with Uganda, Tanzania, and Kenya, something located here. It is the largest tropical lake in the world. Under the Idi Amin regimes in the early 1970s, persons of Indian origin were expelled, but later, by President Museveni, anti-Indian policies were reversed. In 2015, when India conducted India-Africa Forum Summit, more than 40 nations from African continent have participated, which is a great thing. The African continent strongmen like Ghana's Kwame Nkrumah, Congo's Patrice Lumumba, Egypt's Nasser, they maintained a personal strong links with our former Prime Minister, who is the first Prime Minister of India, Jawaharlal Nehru. He understood that India having engagement with Africa is very important in the strategic point of view, economic point of view, and political point of view. Let's see something about India-Africa and China-Africa and India-China-Africa with respect to trade and commerce. Africa exports mostly raw materials and imports manufactured goods. India-Africa trade stands around $62 billion as per 2017-18 report. But it is still no match with China because China's trade with Africa is around $166 billion in 2011 itself. China is the largest trading partner of Africa. How India approaches Africa? How India's policy influences or create impacts in Africa? India wants to create job for Africans, whereas when China invests, it brings its own labor, which creates resentment among the locals. The Chinese model have often been criticized because it creates debts for the nations where it is investing. For example, Nairobi-Mombasa rail link have created huge and enormous debts for Kenya. There are opportunities in African continent, but Indian private sector is yet to take full advantage of the investment climate in Africa. India seeks to strengthen its cultural links with East Africa under the project called Project Mausam. it seeks to revive its linkages with Indian Ocean world, that is East Africa, Arabian Peninsula, Indian Ocean region and Southeast Asia. India's African cross-border connectivity has three forms, namely maritime connectivity, digital connectivity and air connectivity. When it comes to maritime connectivity, it is under the Sagarmala project. Digital connectivity under Pan-African e-network. When it comes to air connectivity, India is facilitating to have direct flights with Indian cities and African cities. India, Japan and many African nations have launched a trilateral initiative which is called the Asia-Africa Growth Corridor. This is a consultative initiative. This will have industrial corridors, industrial network. This will enable India and Africa and Japan to grow together. It will enable win-win situation for all. When it comes to Belt and Road Initiative, it is more of a top-down approach, unilateral approach. That is, it is to secure Chinese interest alone, where the interest of African nations are not given importance. India's security and defense cooperation with Africa is mainly limited to maritime cooperation in the form of anti-piracy operations in the coast of Somalia and deployment of Indian forces in UN peacekeeping missions and regular shipping visits and also naval patrolling in the West Indian Ocean. Last month, China-Africa Security and Defense Forum has been held in Beijing. Through this, China is providing equipments and all the technological support. It also involves in capacity building for African nations. Today's second topic is Detention No Cure on RTE Act Amendment. This topic already we have discussed, but still we will discuss once again. That is, the amendment to the right to education is going to give power to the states to detain students who fail in the class for 5th standard and 8th standard. This is considered as a negative measure because the right to education have been enacted to ensure that all the students get their basic education. During the formative learning phase, a child has to present in classrooms whether he pass or fails. This is the intention of the RTE Act. If the child has a presence during the formative learning phase, he will have some form of education. If at all, if you detain him, there will be a drop in the enrollment ratio, there will be a more dropouts, which is against the letter and spirit of RTE Act. Section 30 class 1 of the RTE Act assures that no child shall be required to face any board exam until he completes elementary education. Government argues that because of no detention policy, the learning outcome is very poor. This is fine, but not only because of students' lack of effort, the learning outcome is poor, but also it involves a lot many other things. The number of teachers, the quality of teachers, the parents' active engagement, and the process of continuous assessment, and the community engagement, etc. In 2016, Niti Aayog stated that if we bring back the detention policy, it would amount to lot of dropouts, especially Dalit and girl children will be affected. Tinkering the RTE Act without much thought will erode the intention, will erode the achievement of this RTE Act. Today's third topic is sanctions relief. There is an act called Countering America's Adversaries Through Sanctions Act. US considers Russia, Iran and North Korea as its adversaries. Any country which have defense cooperation with these adversaries will have to bear the economic sanctions according to this CARSA. But what happened is India made it clear that it will go ahead with S-400 Triumph missile system deal with Russia irrespective of US imposing sanctions or not. This had created a problem, this had created a tension between US and India. But both nations have worked out and devised a plan. According to this plan, President of US can waive sanctions against India once in a 6 months at a time. This waiver is only temporary. We have lot more issues to deal with US. Coming September, we are going to have a 2+2 dialogue with the US. In that 2+2 dialogue, we have to bring all those issues and come to a conclusion, which is win-win situation for both. Today's fourth topic is the Sabarimala singularity. The Supreme Court is currently hearing the oral arguments in the case called Indian Young Lawyers Association versus State of Kerala. Generally, the right to freedom of religion is available to individuals as well as institutions. Article 25 of the Indian Constitution ensures individual rights. Article 26 provides institutional rights, but these both rights are intrinsic facet of liberal democracy. Article 25 recognizes right to freedom of conscience and right to freely profess, practice, propagate religion subject to public order, morality and health. Article 25 2b creates a further exception to this right. It accords the state a power to make a legislation in the interest of social welfare and reform. According to this, it can open Hindu religious institution to any classes of society and is all classes of society and section of Hindus. It includes women also. This is the logic. Article 26 enables a religious institution to manage its own affairs when it comes to the matters of religion. Statutes that were made under Article 25 2b are the exceptions to the freedom of religion that are guaranteed under Article 25 as well as 26 also. Trivankur Devaswam Board argues that Ayyappa is a brahmachari, allowing young women to enter the temple and offer prayers would affect celibacy and austerity of Ayyappa. A law which is favoring autonomy of the group over the autonomy of the individual will have the harmful effect. A denial to women to enter the temple and offer prayers not only denies her religious right but also her equal rights with men. Today's fifth topic is muzzling information. The Right to Information Act 2005 enabled millions of Indians to question the government and hold public functionaries accountable. Yearly, 6 million applications are filed under RTA Act. Most of these applications by the poorest, most marginalized, who seek information about their basic services like ration card, pensions and health facilities. Not only this, the RTA Act has been extensively used to question even the highest officers in the country. The RTA Act fixes the tenure of information commissioners as 5 years, subject to the retirement age of 65 years. The amendments proposed by the central government is to empower the central government to decide the tenure, salaries and allowances of information commissioners. The government argues that information commission is just a statutory body. It is not like election commission, which is a constitutional body. This is a narrow and this is a poor interpretation, because why we give a fixed tenure, why we give a high status to information commissioners are very simple understanding. It is to enable them to function freely, fairly, with transparency and direct even the highest officers in the country to comply with the law. Today's sixth topic is India's Magna Carta. This month marks 100th year of Montagu-Chelmsford report. This Edwin Montagu, the then Secretary of State for India, advocated a wide participation of Indians in British Indian administration. The report also advocated to emancipate local governments and legislature from central control. It will also create responsible governments on the province. The most important point of this particular report is Government of India must remain wholly responsible to Parliament. Montagu Declaration was made in 1917, during which Indian National Congress session was also held. Annie Besant was the head of that INC. This INC session severely criticized this Montagu Declaration. However, Annie Besant accepted the reforms because they are essential for the progress of British India later. The Montagu-Chelmsford reforms would go on to become the basis for Government of India Act 1935, in turn the Constitution of India. The key principles like responsible government, self-governance and federal structure all grow from this particular reform. Thank you.